Aperture.
Thanks for coming tonight to listen to me talk. Without further ado, my talk is going to be mostly about the organic kind of evolution of my work into touching strangers. So at Sunday church services that my family occasionally attended back in the 1970s, we were asked to do something that I remember as being out of the ordinary. The priest asked us to turn to a neighbor seated beside us and offer them the sign of peace in the form of a handshake. So I always looked forward to that part of the service, and I remember it making me feel connected to something larger than my immediate family, which was soon going to be broken apart by my parents' divorce. Handshaking is at least as old as the ancient world, and is believed to have originated as a gesture of nonviolence, demonstrating that the hands held no weapon. This 1864 engraving most likely apocryphally depicts Native Americans shaking hands with Puritan colonists arriving at Plymouth. So I did not know it then, but I was participating in a primeval custom in which it was permissible to put my hands on the body of an unfamiliar person. I grew up in Chicago. This is a little too close. Okay. Right? Don't you think? Okay. So I grew up in Chicago, and I spent my, I lived alone with my mother in a high-rise apartment building along the stretch of Lakeshore Drive known as the Gold Coast. There was a clear distinction between our wealthy neighborhood and Cabrini Green, the notorious housing projects, less than a mile away. Though I was too young to understand America's history of racial division, something seemed unfair to me when my mother took a pen and drew a line on a map that I was forbidden to cross. I questioned why I was allowed to attend public school with children who lived in the projects, or why we shared the same grocery store just blocks away, yet I was forbidden to enter their neighborhood. So I digested from this experience that my life existed on one side of a great divide between people of different races and classes. Another boundary I experienced was the boundary associated with sexuality. This photograph harkens back to my very first post-peanut butter and jelly drag performance. Growing up being attracted to members of the same sex, I understood myself to exist on the periphery of what was sexually normal and permissible. So this is me at my high school junior prom. Not being comfortable with my true feelings, I created a fictional story of who I was, and I did my best to convince others that I was operating in the same sexual arena as them. I dated girls because I thought it was what was expected of me, not what I wanted. And it was a way to shield myself from the suspicion that I was a homosexual and feel safe with the embracing of conformity. When I was 14, I was driven to discard everything I had been taught about the threat of strangers. I started sneaking out to the gay cruising spots in downtown Chicago, looking for discreet sexual encounters. And I was most often the aggressor, and I sought out men nearly twice my age. I wanted a physical connection, but I also felt the desire for friendship and affection that I believed weren't possible living a double life. It's an early self-portrait. Sometimes, men took me home and afterwards touched me tenderly, helping me understand not only palpable desire, but the experience, however brief, of a kind of love between strangers. With photography, I found something that I was good at, and this gave me confidence. So I went on to study it in college, and I graduated with a major in photography from New York University in 2008. So in Pier 45, my first serious body of work following photography school, I photographed the predominantly gay and lesbian scene on the Christopher Street pairs in New York City. I began this work in 1993, and to this very day, I'm still making pictures there. This was film, 35 millimeter, and now I shoot digital SLR. And these are some of the most recent. So the people hanging out there, myself included, we had found a place where we could express ourselves openly and freely. One where we could live without boundaries and be who we wanted to be. Even if they were there for just a couple of hours or only on the weekends, this subculture had crossed the border of what separated them from who they were and who they were expected to be, and from who they actually really were. And sometimes me and my friends would come home from the clubs on a Saturday or Sunday morning and break night hair. So that's my group of friends, and those two were my buddies peeing off the side of the pier. And then we have this terrible homophobic graffiti from someone who doesn't know how to spell. Or they're French, Fagé. So voguing happened primarily on weekend afternoons, and they would bring a boombox and a drum set onto the pier, and we would hang out along the perimeter and watch the Queen, Sashay, and Chante until the sun went down. And this was a really wonderful celebratory experience, and it was a really delight and a marvel to watch the dancing on the pier every weekend. The scene existed on the very edge of Manhattan. As you can see here, the pier was literally crumbling into the Hudson River. This is graffiti from 1994. These kids, many of whom came from traditional macho and religious families throughout the five boroughs, were living on the fringes, and I thought that was a very stark metaphor. Not only were they breaking from the societal norm, but they were also breaking the law, exemplified here in continually cutting through the chain-linked fences used to deter trespassers, or here, by engaging in public sex. I don't think there are many photographs of double blow jobs in public, so I'm pretty proud of this image. So these were some of the boundaries that I encountered as a young man. And you know, we all navigate boundaries, none more so than the established ones between people of different races, sexes, and classes. Whether we are aware of it or not, we do cross these boundaries on a daily basis. And urban life, I think in particular, forces us into shared spaces with members of other tribes. And I believe also that out of this circumstantial destiny, we have largely formed a very functioning, albeit sometimes dysfunctional, family. Navigating through these established and imaginary borders helped to inform who I am today and the subsequent photographic work that I made. I figured out pretty early on that I had a knack for approaching complete strangers and that I suffered a little less than most photographers when walking up to them and asking if I can make their picture. This is an example of me doing just that in Hawaii. Quite possibly that boldness I exhibited as a young gay man in my adolescent sexual pursuits facilitated the courage that I now possess in asking complete strangers to do something extraordinary for me and my camera. Additionally, My mother was always talking the airs off of people she didn't know, and I certainly must have absorbed some of that brazenness. This is my mom, circa 2006. I embraced the idea of the other, and I didn't feel totally crippled by the fear of rejection or the unknown that awaited me when approaching them. This became especially true after I started shooting with the large format view camera, which I felt I had the perfectly legitimate apparatus in which to further my engagement of the unfamiliar. So the majority of my early portraits were made on the street. I found myself photographing objects who, on the surface, I had very little in common with. This early work is from Madison Avenue. I did a whole series called Madison Avenue Portraits, and I started this work in about 1999. And this was the first work I made with a view camera. So these were all made, like, stop people right on the street. And I was really interested and intrigued by this class of people in New York who I felt were, in a way, there was a kinship between the work I did on the piers with the way that people really put so much into their appearance and how they displayed themselves. And it almost also similarly felt like a subculture, a subset. One, of course, albeit a much wealthier subset than the kids I photographed on the piers. This is the only subject I've ever photographed, Laura Johnson, who, when I sent her a copy of the print, she wrote me back with a check for $100. I often think I should just have, like, stayed photographing in that neighborhood for the rest of my life. So, in sort of a, like, a reaction against making photographs of people who I think on their surface appeared not to work at all and have all the time for shopping, I actually decided to do a portrait series on blue-collar workers. And this was as much, I think, an investigation of another socioeconomic class as it was a response to my series of portraits of the uber-rich. This is of a firefighter named Manny who died on September 11th in the World Trade Center. One other thing about the worker series is that I was also inspired by the work of August Sander and his great project, People of the 20th Century. And I've been looking at a lot of large format photography back in the late 90s. And so I thought of similarly of cataloging all the different types of workers. So this is in Newark, and I started a project there, and I wandered around the predominantly black and Portuguese neighborhoods. I walked into beauty shops and groceries, approaching strangers, motivated by my desire to make portraits. In Fresno, I drove through the abandoned city center and roamed the residential neighborhoods, scouting for compelling subjects, subjects whom, by looking at them, you knew that they had a story to tell. This is Christine, and she appears on the cover of my first book, Figure and Ground, which was published by Aperture in 2006. And this is four cousins named Tai, Dai, Soka, and Lei. And they were sitting out front of their house, and I just happened to cross them. I was driving through a neighborhood in Fresno. And they were dressed like that because they had just came from a professional portrait studio where they had their photograph made. So they're not a boy band. And this is Karen. I made this portrait on a very hot day in Fresno, like 105 degrees. And it was an abandoned neighborhood, but I mean, it was a manufacturing district, and it was really quite empty. But I heard some music, And so I went and followed the music. And this is what being curious will do. I followed the music into an auto body shop, and she was in there drinking with these two mechanics, and we're just all hanging out. And so that's how I actually was able to make this picture. In Fall River, Massachusetts, a city that I discovered on my annual summer pilgrimages to Cape Cod, I drove through its working class neighborhoods and wandered through its parks and playgrounds, meeting young men and teenage boys that would allow me and my camera into their world. I returned to Fall River over a dozen times for about 8 years. And I was originally drawn to Fall River because of these old mills. It was at one time the largest cotton milling town in the United States. And I originally went there to photograph, make pictures of the mills, ended up photographing mostly kids that day. I hadn't a lot of experience at that point doing architectural and landscape photography. And so I kind of did what I was comfortable with, which was portraiture. And ended up seeing that there was something there in the telling the story of these kids growing up in Fall River, a place with not a lot of opportunities post-industrial. So I think I was able to visually capture the experience of these young men coming of age in a post-industrial American town, not a lot of economy of which to speak. This is Craig. And I took this shot on a chilly December day. It was probably about 40 degrees out. And beautiful thing about the print is he's covered in goose pimples. So if you ever get a chance to see this print out there, it's a beautiful print. Fall River certainly was on a different track than many other places during the expanding real estate bubble. And it suffered from a non-existent, as I mentioned, to stagnating economy. It's also Fall River is also the town where, in the late 1880s, Lizzie Borden is believed to have murdered her stepmother with an axe. Now, Michael Cunningham, who wrote the introduction to Fall River Boys, he states that, for me, these photographs have to do with American dreams and American decay. With a spinster driven to murder by sheer boredom and her figurative great-great-great-grandsons who might or might not fare better than she did. Part of what I love about photography is that, on the one hand, it almost always implies a story of some kind, and on the other, always implies a story that's enigmatic and fragmentary, an illuminated piece of a tale too vast for even the greatest of novelists, which by its perfect smallness implies something huge. I really like that quote about photography. It's sort of really expansive, the implication that one picture can tell us a story that's almost bigger than a novel. I think this is a beautifully written quote. So with my 8x10 camera in tow, I was crossing into these fantastic zones of unfamiliarity. As a young photographer, unseen connections between strangers in the city became visible to me as the glue linking people and communities, binding each of us together. This is a shot I made on Madison Avenue when I was still shooting with an SLR camera. But I always used to see in Manhattan, Midtown, crowded Midtown scenes, when you're waiting at a stoplight for people to cross, and you see this group of people clustered across the street, and they're all strangers to each other, and that they, for that moment in time, if you're looking at them, they all look like they're somehow connected by being in that cluster, that small space together. And I wanted to do something that kind of was about how I saw the connection between those people. And then in 2004, I began a series of portraits titled See America by Bus. And I traveled to Greyhound stations all across the country documenting the grueling subculture of transcontinental bus travel. And I hope to connect with these travelers for whom the promise of America, for many of whom the promise of America had proven illusory. I think this is such a sad picture. There's just this, everything feels drooping. So it was on these long communal benches in these Greyhound stations that I first confronted the unusual circumstance of asking people who were strangers to each other to pose together in one of my portraits. The challenge of coordinating two or more strangers in the same image appealed to me. And in thinking about how I could expand on that, I thought of this. What would happen if I asked people to touch one another? That question became the genesis for touching strangers. I was curious what the physical vocabulary would look like when a photographer asked strangers approached randomly on the street and who have been introduced to each other only moments before to touch each other's bodies for a photograph. And in asking strangers to touch one another for a photograph, I wondered if it was possible that this might visually illustrate my belief that we human beings are all connected. So with the making of Touching Strangers, I wanted to know also what would happen if I asked my subjects to reach beyond their comfort zone. This is Jeremy and Matthew, and this is actually in the barbecue tent at the Ohio State Fair. So I tell my subjects that I am making family portraits out of strangers, and that the requirement is that they need to touch someone that they have never met. Much in the same way a couple or friends or family members would touch one another. This obviously being a couple. This shot I made in Las Vegas. So I traveled all over the country making this work. The most obvious and frequent gesture that people make when not given instructions on how to touch is either to put their arms around each other's shoulder, extend their arms around the other shoulders, or to hold hands. This was one of the very first ones I made, very tense. So the hesitation on the part of my subjects, it often resulted in these extremely uncomfortable photographs. They were really stiff. Now, many of these early images I now consider to be unsuccessful. This was actually the very first one I made. So I wanted to observe the physical vocabulary that would emerge when I directed these strangers to touch one another, only having met them only moments before. And I soon realized that those very conventional ways that people touch each other was not what I was looking for necessarily. It felt too stiff and conventional. So I needed to step into the role of director and construct a point of contact for many of these pictures. And that was something I wasn't comfortable doing. I hadn't done too much directing of my subjects in my work prior. And I soon realized that to make these pictures more intimate and more compelling, my subjects really needed me to take control. And I soon realized that I had the power to do that, and that taking that power and actually asking for something from a complete stranger, and that just by the mere act of doing that, they responded to that and they gave me something back, which I find to be a gift and quite incredible. So I was really experienced, but as time progressed, I and I did more and more shooting, I started to imagine more complex relationships between my subjects. This image of Jesse and Michael, I made two that day, and you can actually see in the video for Kickstarter the process of me making this picture. So that's still out there online, I think it's on Vimeo and what have you. But this first image I made was of Jesse Michael standing behind the woman, Jesse. And he just was so tall, he kind of overpowered her, and there was like, it felt disconnected. So I thought, okay, what can I do to bring them closer? And I thought, well, he's got to get on his knees. And he made that happen because he was open and receptive to it. So, and I think on that same topic of openness, I think similar to like a stage hypnotist, I learned how to read a subject's, how open they were and open to my suggestions and how much they would be allow themselves to be pushed. And I think also additionally, as a person familiar with the culture of sexual promiscuity, I think I developed an understanding of the potential we possess to engage with very intimate moments with complete strangers on such a primal level. So this is one of the last pictures I made for the project. And I made this in Venice Beach, and this is Ekabong and Andrew. And Ekabong told me she had a boyfriend, and because I wanted them to kiss. And she's like, well, I won't do that because I have a boyfriend. But she said, I will work with you. And so I kind of constructed this pose, and I think it's actually better than a kiss. It's just so sensual and erotic, and it's actually right here. So you can see the yellow is a little different. So the casting, it can be really challenging, depended on chance, good timing, and serendipity. And initially, so when I went out, I would just make an image and choose subjects from whoever was there and in agreement. But as the project progressed, I became more selective, casting as carefully for this project as I would for any of my other projects of making individual portraits. This one was made in New Orleans, and I persevered. I saw this elderly couple walk into a restaurant, the Praline Connection, in the Marinet district, and I was floored by how elegant they both looked and how they seemed ready to be photographed. They're just so elegant and gorgeous and real, and so I was just there for 2 days in New Orleans, and I waited. I went like, okay, I'm gonna maybe ask these people. So I actually went into the restaurant and walked up to their table while they were eating and introduced myself, and I gave them the spiel, and they kind of like rolled their eyes and looked at me suspiciously, and they're like, and they're like, we'll think about it. So then like, one of the waiters came outside for a cigarette and said, and I was like, so you see that couple over there? You gotta get them on board. You gotta talk to them and tell them they should do this. And so like, I did everything in my power to try and like convince this couple to do it. And so then they came out like after me waiting for an hour for them to eat their lunch, and they said, okay, we'll do it. And I was just so excited. So then of course I had to find somebody else. That I could have maybe lost them. So, I mean, that's the part of the challenge is, sometimes you would actually wait, find your first subject, and you wait so long trying to find the second person that the first person or the first persons would then be like, oh, sorry, I gotta go, can't do it. And the whole thing would fall apart. And that happened a number of times, and those are the ones that will never exist. So I have asked my subjects to briefly subvert their expectations about personal space and public appropriateness. And in their body language, we read a large number of silent signals, often more than one present in each person. Tension and submission, affection, I think rigidity, discomfort. This one I made at the Frick here in New York, and this one I actually made a very formal, I wanted them to pose very formally to sort of correspond to the beautiful Turner painting, which I thought was, and the setting, which I thought was also very formal. And then also comedy, another emotion. This was made on the bride's wedding day. They were in Lincoln Park in Chicago, and I saw the wedding party. They were all just kind of hanging out, I think, doing their photographs in the park. And I hemmed and hawed and thought, I can't interrupt them. It's their wedding day. And finally, I built up the courage. And I went up to the bride, and I gave her my spiel. And her wedding party, the bridesmaids were, like, standing around her, and they were kind of giving me the stink eye. And she heard me out, and she said, yeah, I'll do it. And so it came together really quick after that. So I went looking for her companion, and I saw Xavier walking down a path, and he looked great, and I paired them. And like, you know, this picture, kind of wonderful things happen when you start to really look at it, because, and I don't, you know, I wasn't conscious of that when I asked Xavier, but I'd like to say I was. But the wonderful thing about photography is there's serendipity, and things like this happen, like where his pants are covered in embroidery, and of course so is her dress, and he has on a bandana and do-rag that almost looks like a veil, like she does. So I think there's like some really wonderful things can happen just from like doing a lot of photographing. And this shot I made in a motel room at Motel 6 in Tampa. And I knew that I wanted to make a picture in a very intimate space, like a room, a bedroom, that kind of setting. And I had a list over the years of places I wanted to shoot and types of people I wanted to try and photograph. And a hotel was on my list. So, and I do a lot of travel around the country. I like to photograph landscapes and road trip. So this was in a Motel 6, and this was my room. So it was a neutral ground. And I found the guy was in the room next door, and this was the morning when everyone's sort of packing up and getting ready. And it was a nice day, so people had their doors open. And then I saw this woman around the corridor, and she had three kids. Two kids, and then she was pregnant, sorry. So I constructed this picture, and you can really only describe these kind of quadruple portraits as family photographs. There's no other kind of way to look at this, or this. This was on the Ocracoke Island Ferry in North Carolina, and I'll tell you, this woman, the grandmother, of the boy in the yellow, she was so suspicious, and you know, probably no one had ever asked her in her life, to a stranger. A lot of these people, strangers never asked them to take their picture. So that is a very new experience for the subjects, and you know, I got to be pushy, and that's the only kind of way that I got her to do it. You know, and they'll try a little charm thrown in with the pushiness. So sometimes there was like this conscious attempt with my casting to catalog the great variety of races and classes, physiques and professions here in the United States. This one came together in New York, and it was actually featured in the New York Times last summer. When the Kickstarter launched, they were interested in the project, so they had a reporter tail me one day on a shoot. And on my list of things to photograph was an actual Hasidic Jew in New York. I thought it would be very interesting and an unknown variable how the response would be. So I actually went to Williamsburg, which is a Satmar Jewish community, and I like struck out majorly. Like I asked like 5 or 6 people. Of course, I can only ask men because you can't talk to the woman, and the woman wouldn't. You know, there's not. It's not possible to pose them so with another person, except another woman. But so I struck out. But this one guy who worked in the photo industry, who was really close to doing it, I think his name was Abraham, and he was like, well, you might want to try Crown Heights because the Lubavitchers, I always trip over that word, are more open. So I'm like, all right, maybe I'll try there. I was like thinking of like maybe my whole day was just a failure. So I'm like, okay, I have a little more time. I'll drive over there. So I went to Crown Heights, and bammo, found this guy right away. He's like, sure, I'll do it. And this guy was working on unloading a truck across the street. He's like, well, I'll do it. I'll ask my boss, and I'll do it. And so it came together like that. And I mean, it's kind of iconic in the sense that this is a neighborhood that suffered, you know, terrible race riots in the 80s. And so it really speaks to, I think, that history. And I think that, you know, the blacks and Jews in Crown Heights did historically been kind of at each other. And so I feel like this image has this implied kind of building of bridges, to use that metaphor, but connecting those communities. And so it has a lot of, I think, weight. So I think there's also a lot left to chance and serendipity. This I find to be a really romantic picture that I made in front of the Chicago Theater. And the guy in purple was all dressed up really nice. He was going to see Book of Mormon. And then he agreed to do it. And he was with another girl wearing purple. And sometimes I want to actually make a picture of two people, but sometimes I'm interested in just one. So that's something interesting to navigate. How do you try to engage one person in a group when you're really not interested in both? You just want to photograph one. And I've gotten better at that over the years. I feel more comfortable actually asking for what I want. And this woman just came out of the subway, and I just went in and asked her, and then made this very, very, just very sweet pose. And so many of these people look like couples, and I became very interested in the stories that we could tell, where it just was so jarringly confusing, where people looked like they belonged together, as much as the ones where there's this tension or where it doesn't seem like a likely pair. I like both, that both exist side by side in this project. So even with my experience as a street portraitist and fearlessness in approaching strangers, I was stepping outside of my comfort zone every time I made one of these. And so I wonder if it's possible that my own vulnerability contributed to the weightiness that some of these images have. And this image was made in New Bedford, Mass. And this is Petey and Junior. And actually, I saw Petey, who is the limbless guy, walking into a Christian mission building with a pastor. And I was like, I have to try and get him to do it. And so I knocked on the door, and the pastor came out, and he was like, what do you want? And I had to work really hard to get him to trust me. And one way I do that is I have an iPad with me a lot of the times when I shoot, and I can show the subjects examples of of what these pictures look like. And I think that is a really helpful tool in building a little trust between me and my subjects. And then I found Junior with his mother, the guy with the long hair. A lot of people think it's a girl, but he's just a more androgynous looking boy. But Junior was very shy, and Petey was like really engaging and really open. And I really like this picture. It's right there, and it's really bold. I think it's just raw, and it's something that I wanted to be part of this project. I had also had on this my list of types of people I wanted to photograph, someone that was mentally handicapped. And I tried to even, that was something I thought I might have to arrange a little harder, and I did try with some organizations, but it never came together. So this was all just per chance. So Touching Strangers, it kind of is represents my wish to supplant the conventional relationship between photographer and subject. And one way of doing that is it actually submits my subject to the same potential for rejection that I that I put myself in all the time when I ask a stranger. So once someone has agreed that they're gonna make Touching Strangers with me, they're now open to rejection from that third stranger themselves, just like me. And I think that's I think that's sort of new. That experience is kind of well exemplified in this image. I was on San Francisco's Twin Peaks, and another type of person I had always wanted to photograph was a Muslim woman traditionally dressed, and this woman was wearing a hijab, but I saw her second. So the first person I saw was Anna Lee, and Anna Lee's wearing the cheetah print jacket, and I thought she was just fabulous looking and really had a great expressive face in this. And so I went up to her, she was with her husband, and they were from South Carolina, and I explained the project to them, and she kind of looked at him like, and he's like, yeah, do it if you want, honey. I remember he called her honey. And she's like, okay, I'll do it, a little reluctantly. But so then I'm like, okay, so just wait here, and I leave my camera sort of set up. I had unbroken it from the car, and it was set up there. And then I went looking, and then I saw Raekwa coming, and she was with her husband. And I should mention also that Anna Lee was from South Carolina, and she had a really deep Southern accent. And so I found Raekwa, I introduced myself, gave them my spiel, and her husband was with her, and he said, you know, if you want to do it, go ahead. And she said, no, thank you. And I was like, are you sure? And she said, no, thank you anyway. And so I felt really dejected. And simultaneously, I thought, okay, maybe I'm going to ask this woman, and Anna Lee, who's from the South, is going to be biased against Muslim people because, in my mind, I have a bias that Southerners are biased, and that I would be potentially subjecting Raekwa to some uncomfortable, rejection herself. So I went looking for so that didn't happen. So then I went looking for another companion for Anna Lee, and I hear someone say, "Hey, photographer." And I turn around, and Anna Lee has her hand on Raekwa, and they're holding hands. And she had intercepted, Anna Lee had Raekwa, and she told her, "You take a picture with me." So, I mean, like an amazing thing, right? Like that whole experience, I mean, that wouldn't have happened were it not for the subject. And she made that happen. So it's also been suggested that Touching Strangers is a call for people to physically reconnect in an era when so many people are connected to their smartphones, to each other. But that's really conjecture, because I conceived of this project in 2006 about, and that was before even the first iPhone came out and before Facebook was so ubiquitous. But I think it is a pleasant irony or something pleasing about the fact that I'm using this old technology to reconnect people that are so enmeshed in their new technology. Also, if you ask any massage therapist, they will tell you that there is definitely this potential for healing with the power of touch. This image I made in Los Angeles at a gas station. In accordance with that, the healing power of touch, scientists found that the hormone oxytocin is released into the bloodstream when you hold a friend close. So it stimulates touch receptors that are under the skin and can lower your blood pressure and cortisol levels, which would result, of course, in reducing stress and overall measurable health benefits. So the moments captured in these touching, estranging photographs were orchestrated. We tend to often see photographs as a document depicting some truthful event. Excuse me. But the lines between reality and fiction, documentary and stage photography, are blurred in Touching Strangers. These photographs, however, they are fictional, spontaneous relationships acted out as street performances. So the participants, they did not know each other, and they will never probably meet again. And yet, these photographic records of contact will now permanently exist as connections between two or more human beings, all strangers to each other. So on completing one of these photographs, there was often a feeling, I think, among all the participants that something rare and unrepeatable had occurred. This is in Dolores Park in San Francisco, and I really wanted to push that kissing again. And I got a double kiss here from this striking woman in the middle. So viewers of Touching Strangers, they imagine their own stories about the relationships in the photographs. And I think that's because there's this natural and intuitive response that the human mind exercises this, I don't know, it's an ancient impulse or something to delineate the bonds of human interconnection. So someone once wrote to me, one thing that stood out while looking at your photographs was the stories I came up with about the relationships and histories. Even knowing that the people are complete strangers, I still wanted to make sense of who the people are to each other. And that's something that a lot of people have said to me, like they look at them and they have this urge to create a relationship. So I really like that this project plays with that idea of reality. Oops, did I jump ahead? No, okay. So I think Touching Strangers might be about my own search for intimacy and the quest for something missing from my own upbringing. An attempt to visually articulate and to cross the unseen boundaries that separate us from one another. So I wanted to recapture the sentiment that made me so eager to feel the touch of those strange hands on Sunday mornings nearly 40 years ago. It's not wholly an accident that this personal exploration has rippled out for me and connected me with all of you here today. And I think what was originally for me an exploration of human behavioral psychology is for the viewer something quite different. And I think some people have been moved who saw these photographs, they've told me they've been moved to tears or creeped out. Those are two reactions I've got, that they find it disturbing. So I think when I ponder why these pictures resonate with many viewers, the answer lies in that I have engaged in this artistic and sociological experiment that that I think has itself inspired people to see the connections between us. And these connections are the ones we share, members of the human family, and no matter how dysfunctional this family often seems to be, there always exist war and violence and crime. I still think we possess the extraordinary capability of creating bonds between one another.
How important is it for you to already have your camera set up? Do you rely on the fact that people see an 8x10 camera and they're intrigued by that and that's why they want to engage with you? Or do you leave that hidden away and it's just your interaction is what convinces them?
There's no one strategy for that. Sometimes it's set up because I know exactly where I want to shoot, but sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's in the parked car. That's like where it kind of lives because it's very functional to have it in the car. But no, it can go either way. But definitely, of course, the camera itself is a showstopper. People see it on the street and they're curious about it, and you know, it gets its own attention. But I don't feel like I rely on that to actually hook my subjects. I always approach them and introduce myself and explain to them what I'm doing. Certainly, I think that one thing that happens with the process is because it's such a big piece of equipment and they take time to make and it slows down everything compared to a point and shoot. When I'm doing my framing and making my choices about lighting and exposure and composition, the subjects are there with each other and they're chatting, you know, like they're just kind of breaking that silence. And I think that gives them an opportunity to feel a little more comfortable. And also just comfortable, even single portraiture, people get a little more comfortable because they're just standing around waiting for me. I also, you know, I feel a little frustrated sometimes because I'm not able to, I'm not so good at multitasking about being under the cape and asking questions to my subjects because I'm really focused on making the composition and the image. So I sometimes feel like I miss out on some personal information about these people. But that's kind of the nature of photographing a stranger on the street. But some people I have ended up keeping in touch with and getting to know. Cool. Yeah.
You talk about directing people and posing them in this body of work. I was curious, how much of people's natural physicality and body language informs the way that you pose them? Is that something you're working with or against or just disregarding completely?
That's a great question. I don't think there's no way, but I could not work with that because people have the body language that they have. But what I have experienced, what I love, is sometimes people would actually say, that doesn't feel comfortable. Or they've said, how about if I do this? Where they actually, and that's rare. It was always rare that someone become really want to involve themselves in the process because most people are a little more helpless, so I loved it when people stepped up and made their own suggestions. And then I looked at a lot of photography and looked at other examples of couples and through the history of, and you're just noticing also the way couples touched on the street or in a park, and I kind of like tried to incorporate some of those.
Hi. I'm also a photographer. I'm visiting from Tokyo, and thanks for good works and inspiration. I have two questions. One is there any particular reason for you to pick a big 8x10, a classic vintage big camera, instead of a more mobile digital, a smaller camera, in terms of the context of your expression on a which appears on a surface of photography? And my question number two is, do you use any papers, documents, flyers, business cards, anything like that to persuade your models you pick to be in a picture. Do you show your portfolios or anything like that?
Oh yeah, I think I mentioned during the talk that I bring an iPad with me and I show them examples of the other work I've made. So it illustrates to them that I'm like the real deal and not like some, perv. So to answer your first question about, what was it again?
Is there any particular reason why you choose
8x10?
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm an addict. no, I mean, that's really the base response that I love 8x10, and I like the engagement that it offers, which I think is a slower engagement with your subject. And I'm not a smooth sort of like coordinated person. I was never good at sports and I was klutzy. So somehow the view camera, which you really can't be klutzy with, it somehow trained me. It slowed me down in the creative process. And I think it suited me. And I also just love, besides the engagement, you can't make a picture this big with that much detail, even with, still the best like high-res medium format digital camera. I mean, it's getting close, but I still think there's a difference between responding to a photographer who has a camera on a tripod rather than a handheld camera. I just think the interaction is ultimately different. Though, to contradict that, I become a big photographer with my iPhone. I like having this like dream when we were all younger of, if we could just have a camera that fit in our pocket. And the lenses are getting better, the technology is better. I mean, you can make pretty nice small prints from these. And I think the Touching Strangers project actually gave me the experience and the confidence to go up to someone on the street with my iPhone that I'm just like, I'm floored by some person that I see in New York that I want to take their picture right then and there. And I will, and I'll go up to them and like, I'll just direct them. I'll just tell them exactly what to do. And I don't think I would have done that, a few years ago. And I think Touching Strangers really gave me the skills to take control of a situation. So, the view camera does contribute, but I think ultimately it's you as the photographer that makes those things happen.
Have you ever heard from somebody that you've shot like months or a year later that told you something that has altered in their life as a result of the experience?
When the book was coming out and there was been a lot of press for this project, as you guys probably know, so some of the press wanted to make inquiries to the subjects, and so I did actually, that question was asked to the subjects, and I was a part of that email chain or that response loop, and there were a couple of people that wrote that moment was really special to them. This guy, Michael, had not been photographed in, I think, 20 years. And he wrote to The Guardian, did a piece about a month ago. And he wrote something so touching that for him, that this experience really like was an opening. It opened him up in a way that he hadn't been in years. So, I mean, I don't think that, one photograph can change a person's life necessarily unless it's a scandalous one. But I do, I was really touched to hear that some people were affected by the experience. But for the most part, I think everyone just, it was an unusual thing that happened in their day and then they went on with their lives day to day, just as any of us would. So.
Since you started this project, did you see changes on the behavior of people across the years in the way that people actually touch each other or talk to each other or just make the approach that you need, because I understood that you started years ago.
Do you mean more like, did I notice any cultural changes?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, people is more open to do it. People is more...
I don't think so. It's a good question, but I don't think so.
How much did you explain to the subjects what you expect your end result to be, like gallery shows and book? And
oh, I always mention a book.
So they knew that even if it's potentially awkward, it'll be printed. Or was there anyone that agreed to the picture but didn't want it to be published later?
Yes. The woman in Superior, her name is Arlie, and she's a psychic, and she worked for, like, did something for Fox News, too. And when she, I had an email exchange with her, and she's like, I really don't like that picture of me. Can you please not use it? And I just kind of ignored that because it's a great picture. It's actually people, it's like one that like people really seem drawn to and has been reproduced a lot. So I'm sorry, but she looks awesome in that picture and she's wrong.
I guess to follow up with that, Richard, do you get model releases from your subjects when you photograph them? Or do you?
I do, but I don't need them. Nor do any of you if you're using the picture for art or editorial purposes. I do it as just a way to keep track of who I photographed and get their contact information. And, you know, sometimes I feel like a private detective, though, because I have to decipher people's handwritings, and sometimes that's really hard. And there are these apps that people use, but I just, I feel like stuck in my old system of paper. But you don't need them for consensual, in the public, art photography. It's not necessary.
Do you give them a copy?
I do. I send everyone a copy. I send them a JPEG and an 8x10 work print.
Okay.